गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स इन द फर्स्ट चैप्टर वी डिस्कस्ड व्हाट इज माइक्रो इकोनॉमिक्स एंड मैक्रो इकोनॉमिक्स वी आल्सो लर्न अबाउट द कंपोनेंट्स फीचर्स एंड फंक्शंस ऑफ मैक्रो इकोनॉमिक्स नाउ लेट मी इंट्रोड्यूस द सेकेंड चैप्टर नेशनल इनकम अकाउंटिंग दिस चैप्टर डील्स विद व्हाट इज नेशनल इनकम एंड हाउ इट इज कैलकुलेटेड इन दिस चैप्टर वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट व्हाट इज सिंपल इकोनॉमी and its fundamental functions. In section 2.1, we will explore some basic concepts of macroeconomics and 2.2, we will understand how to calculate the aggregate income of the nation in circular method. The other section of this lesson also deal with the three ways to calculate the national income, namely product method, expenditure method and income method. Section 2.3 describes the various categories of national income such as GDP, deflator, consumer price index, wholesale price indices, etc. and to discuss the problems associated with taking GDP of a country as an indicator of the aggregate welfare of the people of the country. Section 2.1 deals some basic concepts of macroeconomics. To understand the basic concepts of macroeconomics, you must understand the following questions. The first question is, what generates the economic wealth of a nation? The second question is, what makes countries rich or poor? It is not necessary to become a rich country blessed with rich natural wealth such as minerals, forests or the most fertile lands, etc. For example, the Republic of Congo in Africa and Brazil in Latin American region possess rich sources of natural wealth. But both these countries are one of the poorest countries in the world. Whereas many prosperous countries like Japan have scarcely any natural wealth, but they are economically developed countries in the world. Its possession of natural resources had to be transformed through a production process. Thus, the economic wealth or well-being of a country does not necessarily depend on the mere possession of resources. It is understood that these resources are used in generating a flow of production and how, as a consequence, income and wealth are generated from the process. So how do we produce the goods and services? From where does this production flow arise? When people combine their physical work, that is their energy, with natural and man-made environment, with the technological structure, there is a flow of production. This production of commodities may be done either by small or large enterprises consisting of a large number of people or single entrepreneur. So after the production of these commodities, that is goods and services, it is sold out from the smallest pins or buttons to the largest ones like aeroplanes, automobiles, giant machineries or any saleable services like that of the doctor, the lawyer or the financial consultant, etc. The goods and services produced are to be sold to the consumer. The consumer may in turn be an individual or an enterprise, and good or service purchased by that entity might be for final use or for use in further production. Thus, a farmer producing cotton sells it to a spinning mill where the raw cotton undergoes transformation to yarn. The yarn is in turn sold to a textile mill where through the productive process it is transformed into cloth. The cloth is in turn transformed through another productive process into an article of clothing, which is then ready to be sold finally to the consumers for final use. Such an item that is meant for final use and will not pass through any more stages of production or transformations is called final goods. Before you understand final goods, and you must understand different types of goods that used in economy. Very first, you have to understand what is called goods. Any physical objects or man-made things that could determine a price in the market, and these are the materials that satisfy human needs and provide utility, is called goods. Now you will understand final goods. Now final goods is classified into two as consumption goods and capital goods. Consumption goods, consumer goods. Goods like food and clothing and services like recreation that are consumed when purchased by their ultimate consumer are called consumption goods or consumer goods. Goods are, this is also includes capital goods. Those final goods which help in production and is used for generating income. These goods, fixed assets of the producer. Example, plant and machinery. Here, plant does not mean tree plant. It refers to the industrial plant. Consumer durables. The goods that have a relative long life as compared to articles like food and clothing. They don't need repairs and replacement of parts. They are not extinguished by immediate or short period of consumption like foods or any perishable items. These goods are called consumer durables. The next one is intermediate goods. These goods are referred to those goods and services which are used as a raw material for further production or for resale in the same year. These goods do not fulfill needs of mankind directly. Example, steel sheets used for making automobiles and copper used for making utensils. Now, to have a comprehensive idea of the total flow of production in the economy, we need to have a quantitative measure of the aggregate level of final goods produced in the economy. However, in order to get a quantitative assessment, a measure of the final goods and services produced in the economy, it is obvious that we need a common measuring rod. We cannot add meters of cloth produced in a textile industry to tons of rice produced in the agricultural field or number of automobiles or machineries produced in a factory. Our common measuring rod is money. Since each of these commodities is produced for sale, the sum total of the monetary value of these diverse commodities gives us a measure of final output. At this stage, it is important to introduce the accepts of stocks and flow. The variable measured at a specific time and represents a quantity existing at that point of time is called stock. The variable measured over an interval of time is called flow. The flow is measured per unit of time. For example, a tank is being filled with water coming from a tap. The amount of water which is flowing into the tank from the tap per minute is a flow. But how much water there is in the tank at a particular point of a time is a stock concept. This example is given in the textbook itself. If you want a further clarification, you read from the book. Now, there are certain technical terms you must know to understand the concept of the lesson. What is investment? Addition made to physical stock of capital during a period of time is called investment. It is also called capital formation. What is gross investment? The total addition made to the capital stock of an economy at a given period of time is called gross investment. What is net investment? The actual addition made to the capital stock of an economy at a given period of time is called gross investment. Next one is depreciation. The deletion made from the value of gross investment in order to accommodate regular wear and tear of capital is called depreciation. So new addition to capital stock in an economy is measured by net investment or new capital formation, which is expressed as net investment equal to gross investment minus depreciation. Let us consider a new machine is invested in a firm. This machine may be in service for the next 20 years, after which it falls into this repair and needs to be replaced. We can now imagine as if the machine is being gradually used up in every year's production process, and each year 1/20th of its original value is getting depreciated. So instead of considering a bulk investment for replacement after 20 years, we consider an annual depreciation cost every year. This is the usual sense in which the term depreciation is used, and inherent in its conception is the expected life of a particular capital good, like 20 years in our example of the machine. Depreciation is thus an annual allowance for wear and tear of a capital good. In other words, it is the cost of the good divided by number of years of its useful life. Notice here that depreciation is an accounting concept, but there will be a steady flow of actual replacement spending, which will more or less match the amount of annual depreciation being accounted for in the economy. Now getting back to the discussion of final output of an economy, that is output of consumption and capital goods. The consumer goods sustain the consumption of the entire population of an economy. Purchase of consumer goods depends on the capacity of the people to spend on these goods, which in turn depends on their income. The other part of that is the capital goods are purchased by business enterprises. They are used either for maintenance of the capital stock, because there are wear and tear of it, or they are used for addition to their capital stock in a specific time period. For example, a year, the total production of final goods can thus be either in the form of consumption or investment. This implies that there is a trade-off. If an economy produces more of consumer goods, it is producing less of capital goods and vice versa. More production of newer varieties of capital goods would help in the great production of consumer goods. Let us understand how time influences the production of an economy. If a larger share goes for production of capital goods, a smaller share is available for consumer goods at a particular period given in a level of total output of the economy. It is true if more capital goods are produced, less of consumer goods would be produced, but production of more capital goods would mean that in future of the laborers would have more capital equipments to work with. This leads to a higher capacity of the economy to produce same number of laborers. Thus total input would be higher when less capital goods were produced. If total output is higher, the amount of consumer goods that can be produced would surely be higher. Higher production of capital goods enables the economy to expand. Since we are dealing with all goods and services that are produced for the market, the crucial factor enabling such sale is demand for such products backed by purchasing power. One must have the necessary ability to purchase commodities, otherwise one's need for commodities does not get recognized by the market. We have already discussed above that one's ability to buy commodities come from the income one earns as laborer earning wages, or as entrepreneur earning profits, or as landlord that is earning rents, or as owner of capital that is earning interest. In short, the incomes that people earn as owners of factors of production are used by them to meet their demand for goods and services. So we can see a circular flow here, which is facilitated through the market. Simply put, the firm's demand for factors of production to run the production process creates payments to the public. In turn, the public's demand for goods and services creates payments to the firms and enables the sale of the products they produce. So the social act of consumption and production are intricately linked, and in fact there is a circular causation here. The process of production in an economy generates factor payments for those involved in production and generates goods and services as the outcome of the production process. The income so generated create the capacity to purchase the final consumption goods and thus enables their sale by the business enterprises, the basic object of their production. The capital goods which are also generated in the production process also enables their producers to earn income, wages, profits, etc. In a similar manner, the capital goods add to or maintain the capital stock of an economy and thus make production of other commodities possible. Next topic, circular flow of income and methods of calculating national income. Before understanding about circular flow of income due to production, you must understand the factors of production and their remunerations. Here, factors of productions are four types. They are labor, capital and entrepreneur. Here land, it comprises of all physical factors such as air, water, wind, etc., whose remuneration is rent. The next one is labor. It includes the inputs of human labor whose remuneration is wage. The third one is capital. It is the tangible investment used for production process. It is used to produce consumer goods and services. The fourth one is entrepreneurs. It is the one who invests his own capital and takes the risk to start the production process or business, whose remuneration is profit. But how these factors of production influence a simple economy using their remunerations? In this simplified economy, there is only one way in which the households may dispose of their earnings, by spending their entire income on the goods and services produced by the domestic firms. The other channels of disposing their income are closed. We have assumed that the households do not save. They do not pay taxes to the government, since there is no government, and neither do they buy imported goods, since there is no external trade in this simple economy. In other words, the factors of production use their remunerations to buy the goods and services which they assisted in producing. The aggregate consumption by the households of an economy is equal to the aggregate expenditure on goods and services produced by the firms in the economy. The national income accounting entire income of the economy therefore comes back to the producers in the form of sales revenue there is no leakage from the system. There is no difference between the amount that the firms had distributed in the form of factor payments, which is the sum total of the remunerations earned by the four factors of production and age and the aggregate consumption expenditure that they receive as sales revenue. In the next period, the firms will once again produce goods and services and pay remunerations to the factors of production. These remunerations will once again be used by the goods and services. Hence, year after year, we can imagine the aggregate income of the economy going through the two sectors, firms and households, in a circular way. This is represented in the figure when the income is being spent on the goods and services produced by the firms. It takes the form of aggregate expenditure received by the firms. Since the value of expenditure must be equal to the value of goods and services, we can equivalently measure the aggregate income by calculating the aggregate value of goods and services produced by the firms. When the aggregate revenue received by the firms is paid out to the factors of production, it takes the form of aggregate income. In the figure of the uppermost arrow going from the households to the firms represents the spending of households undertake to buy goods and services produced by the firms. The second arrow going from the firms to the households is the counterpart of the arrow above. It stands for the goods and services which are flowing from the firms to the households. In other words, this flow is what the households are getting from the firms for which they are making the expenditures. In short, the two arrows on the top represent the goods and services market. The arrow above represents the flow of payments for the goods and services. The arrow below represents the flow of goods and services. The two arrows at the bottom of the diagram similarly represents the factors of production market. The lower most of arrow going from the households to the firm symbolizes the services that the households are rendering to the firms. Using these services, the firms are manufacturing the output. The arrow above is going from the firms to the households represents the payments made by the firms to the households for the service provided by the latter. For this topic, questions may be asked in various ways. Here are some examples of questions. Explain about a simplified economy with the example, or enumerate the points of circular flow of income with a neat diagram. The next question, prove the statement of the aggregate consumption by the households is equal to the aggregate expenditure on goods and services produced by the firms in an economy. Let us now discuss about the methods to calculate the national income of an economy. This is a very important part of this lesson, so learn this clearly. Since the same amount of money representing the aggregate value of goods and services is moving in a circular way, if we want to estimate the aggregate value of goods and services produced during a year, we can measure the annual value of the flows at any of the indicated in the given diagram. We can measure the uppermost flow at point A by measuring the aggregate value of spending that the firms receive for the final goods and services which they produce. This method will be called the expenditure method. If we measure the flow at B by measuring the aggregate value of final goods and services produced by all the firms, it will be called product method. at sea, measuring the sum of a total of all factor payments will be called income method. Before going to calculate the national income by these methods, let us discuss about a macroeconomic model. What is macroeconomic model? A story which describes the imaginary model of an economy is called a macroeconomic model. And it is also important to note that the aggregate spending of the economy must be equal to the aggregate income earned by the factors of production. Why I say this is, while calculating the national income using various methods, we have to consider about some models. Let us now calculate the national income using the first method, that is value-added method, which is also called as product method. Value-added method or product method. In the product method, we calculate the aggregate annual value of goods and services produced at a particular time that may also be a year. It shows the contribution of each producing unit in a production process. Let us suppose that there are only two kinds of producers in the economy. They are the wheat producers or the farmers and the bread makers, the bakers. The wheat producer grows wheat and they do not need any input other than human labor. They sell a part of the wheat to the bakers. The baker do not need any other raw materials besides wheat to produce bread. Let us suppose that in a year the total value of wheat that the farmers have produced is rupees 100. Out of this, they have sold rupees 50 worth of wheat to the bakers. The bakers have used this amount of wheat completely during the year and have produced rupees 200 worth of bread. What is the value of total production in the economy? If we follow the simple way of aggregating the value of production of these sectors, we could add rupees 200 value of production of the bakers to rupees 100 value of production of farmers. The result will be rupees 300. A little reflection will tell us that the value of aggregate production is not rupees 300. The farmers had produced rupees 100 worth of wheat for which it did not need assistance of any inputs. Therefore the entire rupees 100 is rightfully the contribution of the farmers, but the same is not true for the bakers. The bakers had to buy rupees 50 worth of wheat to produce their bread. The rupees 200 worth of bread that they have produced is not entirely their own contribution. To calculate the net contribution of the bakers, we need to subtract the value of wheat that they have brought from the farmers. If we do not do this, we shall commit the mistake of double counting. What is double counting? This is because rupees 50 worth of wheat will be counted twice. First, it will be counted as part of the output produced by the farmers. Second time, it will be counted as the imputed value of wheat in the bread produced by the bakers. Therefore, the net contribution made by the baker is rupees 200 minus rupees 50 is equal to 150. Hence, aggregate value of goods produced by this simple economy is rupees 100 net contribution by the farmers plus rupees 150 net contribution by the bakers is equal to rupees 250. The term that is used to denote the net contribution made by a firm is called its value added. The raw materials that a firm buys from another firm, which are completely used up in the process of production, are called intermediate goods. Therefore, the value added of a firm is value of production of the firm value of intermediate goods used by the firm. The value added of a firm is distributed among its four factors of production, namely labor, capital, entrepreneurship, and land. Therefore, wages, interest, profits, and rents paid out by the firm must add up to the value added of the firm. Value added is flow variable. Here, all the variables are expressed in terms of money. When we can think of the market prices of the goods being used to evaluate the different variables listed here, and we can introduce more players in the chain of production in the example and make it more realistic and complicated. For example, the farmers may be using fertilizers or pesticides to produce wheat. The value of these inputs will have to be deducted from the value of output of wheat. Or the bakers may be selling the bread to a restaurant whose value added will have to be calculated by subtracting the value of intermediate goods, bread in this case. We have already introduced the concept of depreciation, which is also known as consumption of fixed capital. Since the capital which is used to carry out production undergoes wear and tear, the producer has to undertake replacement investments to keep the value of capital constant. The replacement investment is same as depreciation of capital. If we include depreciation in value added, then the measure of value added that we obtain is called gross value added. If we deduct the value of depreciation from gross value added, we obtain net value added. Unlike gross value added, net value added does not include wear and tear that capital has undergone. For example, let us say a firm produces rupees 100 worth of goods per year. Rupees 20 is the value of intermediate goods used by it during the year, and rupees 10 is the value of capital consumption. The gross value added of the firm will be rupees 100 minus rupees 20 is equal to 80 per year. The net value of added will be rupees 100 minus 20 minus rupees 10 is equal to rupees 70 per year. It is to be noted that while calculating the value added, we are taking the value of production of firm. But a firm may be unable to sell all of its produce. In such a case, it will have some unsold stock at the end of the year. Conversely, it may so happen that a firm had some initial unsold stock to begin with. During the year that follows, it has produced very little, but it has met the demand in the market by selling from the stock it had at the beginning of the year. How shall we treat these stocks which a firm may intentionally or unintentionally carry with itself also? Let us remember that a firm buys raw materials from other firms. The parts of raw material which gets used up is categorized as an intermediate good. What happens to the part which does not get used up? In economics, the stock of unsold finished goods or semi-finished goods or raw materials which a firm carries from one year to the next year is called inventory. Inventory is a stock variable. It may have a value at the beginning of the year. It may have a higher value at the end of the year. In such a case, inventories have increased or accumulated. If the value of inventories is less at the end of the year compared to the beginning of the year. Inventories have decreased. Decumulated. We can therefore infer that the change of inventories of a firm during a year is equal to production of the firm during the year minus sale of the firm during the year. The sign triple horizontal line stands for identity. Unlike equality, that is a two parallel horizontal line, and identity always holds irrespective of what variables we have on the left hand and right hand side of it. For example, we can write 2 plus 2 in identity 4, because this is always true, but we must write 2 into x equal to 4. This is because 2 times x equals to 4 for a particular value of x, namely when x equal to 2, and not always. We cannot write 2 into x identity 4. Observe that since the production of the firm identity value added plus intermediate goods used by the firm, we get a change of inventories of a firm during a year. Identity value added plus intermediate goods used by the firm minus sale of the firm during a year. For example, let us suppose that the firm had an unsold stock worth of rupees 100 at the beginning of a year. During the year, it had produced rupees 1000 worth of goods and managed to sell rupees 800 worth of goods. Therefore, the rupees 200 is the difference between production and sales. This is rupees 200 worth of goods is the change in inventories. This will add to the rupees 100 worth of inventories the firm started with. Hence, the inventories at the end of the year is rupees 100 plus rupees 200 is equal to rupees 300. Notice that change in inventories take place over a period of time. Therefore, it is flow variable. Inventories are treated as capital. Addition to the stock of capital of a firm is known as investment. Therefore, change in the inventory of a firm is treated as investment. There can be three major categories investment. First is the rise in the value of inventories of a firm above over a year, which is treated as investment expenditure undertaken by the firm. The second category of investment is the fixed business investment, which is defined as the addition to the machinery, factory, buildings and equipment employed by the firms. The last category of the investment is the residential investment, which refers to the addition of housing facilities. Change in inventories may be planned or unplanned. In case of an unexpected fall in sales, the firm will have unsold stock of goods which it had not accepted or anticipated. Hence, there will be an unplanned accumulation of inventories. In the opposite case, where there is an unexpected rise in the sale, there will be an unplanned decumulation of inventories. This can be illustrated with the help of the following example. Suppose a firm produces shirts. It shirts the year with an inventory of 100 shirts. During the coming year, it expects to sell 1000 shirts. Hence, it produces 1000 shirts, expecting to keep an inventory of 100 at the end of the year. However, during the year, the sale of shirts turn out to be unexpectedly low. The firm is able to sell only 600 shirts. This means that the firm is left with 400 unsold shirts. The firm ends the year with 400 plus 100 is equal to 50 shirts. The unexpected rise of inventories by 400 will be an example of unplanned accumulation of inventories. If, on the other hand, the sale had been more than 100, we would have unplanned decumulation of inventories. For example, if the sales had been 1050, when not only the production of 1000 shirts will be sold, the firm will have to sell 50 shirts out of the inventory. This 50 unexpected reduction in inventories is an example of unexpected decumulation of inventories. What can be the example of planned accumulation or decumulation of inventories? Suppose the firm wants to raise the inventories from 100 shirts to 200 shirts during the year, expecting sales of 1000 shirts during the year. As before, the firm produces 1000 plus 100 is equal to 1100 shirts. If the sales are actually 1000 shirts, then the firm indeed ends up with a rise of inventories. The new stock of inventories is 200 shirts, which was indeed planned by them. This rise is an example of planned accumulation of inventories. On the other hand, if the firm had wanted to reduce the inventories from 100 to 25, say, then it would produce 1000 minus 75 is equal to 925 shirts. This is because it plans to sell 75 shirts out of the inventory of 100 shirts it started with, so that the inventory at the end of the year become 100 minus 75 is equal to 25 shirts, which the firm wants. If the sales indeed turn out to be 1000 as expected by the firm, the firm will be left with the planned reduced inventory of 25 shirts. Do you remember what is GDP? Already we have discussed about what is GDP. It is the sum of total gross value added of all the firms in an economy. It is abbreviated as gross domestic product. It can be expressed in the form of equation as GDP identical to GVA 1 plus GVA 2 plus etc. plus GVA n. Therefore, GDP identical to sigma n, the bottom is T is equal to 1, GVA T times, where GVA 1 is the gross value added of firm 1, GVA 2 is the gross value added of firm 2, whereas GVA n is the gross value added of nth firm, that is firm n. Therefore, GDP is identical to summation of T is equal to 1 to n GVA T, where T is the firm number. Let us further understand the sigma concept through an example. The symbol sigma is a notation minus, it is used to denote summation. Suppose there are three students having pocket money of rupees 200, 250 and 350 respectively. We can say if ith student has pocket money xi, then x1 is equal to 200, x2 is equal to 250, x3 is equal to 350. The total pocket money will be given by x1 plus x2 plus x3. The summation notation given above is useful in writing it in a shorter form. X1 plus X2 plus X3 can be written as summation sigma 3 I equal to 1 X1, which means that there are three value of X corresponding to the three individuals from 1 to 3, and we are referring to the sum of the value of X for individuals from 1 to 3. this notation is particularly useful in macroeconomics, since we deal with in a much shorter form, since we are deal with aggregates. For instance, suppose there are 1,000 consumers in the economy having consumption C1, C2, etc. C1,000. If we want to compute the aggregate consumption for this economy, we have to add up all these values, which means aggregate consumption for this economy will be given by capital C is equal to C1 plus C2 plus etc. infinity plus C1,000. The summation notation, however, allows to write it in a much shorter form. Since we are summing up the values of consumption for individual 1 to individual 1,000, where the value of consumption for the individual I is C, aggregate consumption will be C is equal to sigma 1,000 I equal to 1 C1. In general, we are taking some of the quantity xi over individuals 1 to n. It will be denoted by sigma ni is equal to 1 xi. With this, the first part of this lesson from the NCERT grade economic book part B, page from 9 to 20 is completed, and the next part of the same lesson will be continued in the second video. If you have any doubts, please make a note and get it clear in the regular class after school reopening. Thank you. Goodbye.